The SSPL, or server-side public license, is still hotly contested. One side saying it is absolutely not open source, the other saying, well, it's basically AGPL v3. And if AGPL v3 is open source, and this is pretty much just an extreme AGPL v3, shouldn't it also be open source? So this is a license developed by MongoDB Inc. back in 2018 for use with their project, which they moved to from the AGPL v3, which explains the resemblance. Since then, some other large projects like Elastic and Redis have adopted the license. Now, they also have other licenses available as well. In the case of Elastic, they had the Elastic license, and Redis has RCLV2. Now, due to the negative reception around SSPL and also their other licenses, they have since added AGPL v3 as an option, at least in one of their tiers. And even though there is a lot of debate about the license, MongoDB maintains the stance, although the SSPL is not OSI approved, that being the Open Source Initiative, the organization that gives us the open source definition, it maintains all the same freedoms the community always had with MongoDB under AGPL, AGPL v3 specifically. Users are free to review, modify, and distribute the software or redistribute modifications to the software. However, the Open Source Initiative has its own process for approving what it considers to be an open source license, and the SSPL has not received OSI approval. MongoDB software licensed under the SSPL is not considered open source by the OSI. So they acknowledge that it's not open source by the OSI, but they still effectively treat it like it is open source. And by the end of the video, you'll understand why there is this contention. And others who've adopted it, like Elastic and Redis, basically all have the same stance. Now, you might want to initially apply negative intentions here. They're doing this for money, they're doing this for this, they're doing this for that. For the sake of right now, let's just assume that everyone that adopts this license is doing so in good faith. I don't know what's happening inside their heads. Let's just look at what is happening. We'll get to intentions later. Why is there a problem? Well, I think the easiest way to answer that is looking at both the SSPL and AGPL v3. Now, technically, the SSPL is not based on the AGPL v3. Instead, it is based on the GPL v3, which the AGPL v3 is also based on. So effectively what they've done is recreated the AGPL v3 from first principles with a slightly different goal in mind. Now, when I say both the SSPL and the AGPL v3 borrow a lot of their license text from the GPL v3, I really do mean that. If you do a diff of all of these licenses, the majority of the text you see will be identical. And that's fine. That is totally normal in license development. If there is a license that works, there's no point reinventing the wheel. The main area of contention, though, is point number 13, offering the program as a service. In AGPL v3, that would be remote network interaction and used with the GNU general public license, that being the GPL. Let's first start with the AGPL v3. Firstly, though, we need to define corresponding source. The corresponding source for a work in object code form, so in compiled form, means all the source code needed to generate, install, and for an executable work, run the object code and to modify the work, including scripts to control those activities. So everything you need to modify the application, to build the application, to run the application, if there are scripts involved in doing so, those as well. Basically, what you would normally include in a Git repo that you would make public. However, it does not include the work's system libraries or general purpose tools or generally available free programs which are used unmodified in performing those activities, but which are not part of the work. So this would not include your operating system kernel, your Unix toolkit, your C library, your C compiler, things that are generally available, but not part of your project, even though they would also be required to run the application. It's not saying those cannot be included, but they are not a requirement to be included to meet this term of the license. Back to point number 13, notwithstanding any other provision of this license, if you modify the program, your modified version must promptly offer all users interacting with it remotely through a computer network, if your version supports such interaction, an opportunity to receive the corresponding source of your version by providing access to the corresponding source from a network server at no charge through some standard or customary means of facilitating copying of software. This corresponding source shall include the corresponding source for any work covered by version 3 of the GNU General Public License that is incorporated pursuant to the following paragraph. TLDR, let's say you are running a server, and that server is running a piece of modified AGP or V3 software, and this server is being accessed by people in the public. You are running a software as a service. Somewhere in your system, somewhere in your service, it needs to offer users access to the source code of your modified version. Now, some companies like to play fast and loose with this term right here, customary means of facilitating copying of software. So this is a license that was written in 2007. Back then, it was still quite common to distribute code on CDs and things like that. Now, someone doing things sensibly would go over a network server, no charge. Companies will sometimes do things like, oh, well, we'll send you a CD with the version on it on the slowest freight possible. And because of this very ambiguous term here, this ambiguous phrasing, is that against the license? Some people argue it's against the spirit of it. Is it against what's actually written, though? You know, ask a lawyer that one. As for part two, notwithstanding any other provision of this license, you have permission to link or combine any covered work with a work license under version 3 of the GNU General Public License into a single combined work and to convey the resulting work. The terms of this license will continue to apply to the part which is the covered work, but the work with which it is combined will remain governed by version 3 of the GNU General Public License. Basically, you can combine AGP or V3 software with GP or V3 software, and the AGP or V3 software remains AGP or V3 licensed, the GP or V3 software remains GP or V3 licensed, but they can be used together. Now for the SSPL. If you make the functionality of the program or a modified version available, so the plain vanilla version, or you modify it, available to third parties as a service, you are running a software as a service, you are, say, offering MongoDB on AWS, things like that, you must make the service source code. Note, different term than corresponding source, available via network download to everyone at no charge under the terms of this license. We'll get to the definition of service source code in just a moment, but I do think this part here is actually an improvement over the AGP or V3, not providing the loophole of a customary means of facilitating copying of software. This requires it to be some form of network download. Now, it could be a very slow network download on a very bad server, on a very unstable server, but at least it has to be on a network, not a CD over freight. Making the functionality of the program or modified version available to third parties as a service includes, without limitation, enabling third parties to interact with the functionality of the program or modified version remotely through a computer network, offering a service the value of which entirely or primarily derives from the value of the program or modified version, or offering a service that accomplishes for users the primary purpose of the program or modified version. If you're using MongoDB on your backend, for example, and you're not offering MongoDB as a service, that would not be covered by this. But if your primary purpose is offering MongoDB as a service, again, like AWS or like a Google Cloud, that would be covered by the license. So what in fact is service source code? This means the corresponding source for the program or the modified version and the corresponding source for all programs that you use to make the program or modified version available as a service, including without limitation, management software, user interfaces, application program interfaces, automation software, monitoring software, backup software, storage software, and hosting software, all such that the user could run an instance of the service using the service source code you make available. What does this actually mean? In short, and this is why there is such contention about the license. Let's say that your system is powered by a Linux system, and let's say you have some sort of proprietary interface to interact with the database, and let's say you're running some proprietary drivers on your system. To fulfill the terms of the license, you must release the source code for everything. Everything required to run the software as a service, from the operating system level to the user interface level, not just the corresponding source for the application. Everything in the stack. This includes things you don't have the legal right to release. This includes things that you don't have access to the source code of. Everything required to run it as a service. Even more importantly, under the terms of this license. So everything must be released under the terms of the SSPL. So the only way to actually fulfill this requirement is build everything with permissive software or build everything from the ground up under the SSPL, from the operating system to the user interface. Basically creating a situation where you cannot fulfill the terms of the license and you cannot offer this software as a service. But this is why some people still argue it might be open source. This is effectively copyleft taken to its logical conclusion. So people like to describe copyleft licenses as viral and infecting a system. And that's not really fair in a lot of cases. The SSPL is, if you choose to offer SSPL software as a service, everything has to be infected by it. Now, based on the terms of the open source definition, some members of the OSI disagree on this license being open source. So there are two main points they disagree on. Firstly, point number 9. The license must not place restrictions on other software that is distributed along with the licensed software. For example, the license must not insist that all other programs distributed on the same medium must be open source software. And it's pretty easy to argue that this is one of the things the SSPL is trying to do. But you can also look at it in another way, where it's saying that unless everything is compatible with the license, it cannot be shipped alongside this. Like, say, with GPL software or AGPL software, where if it's not compatible with that license, it cannot be integrated into that work. It's just expanding the work from being just the work to the entire system. But also point number 6, no discrimination against fields of endeavor. The license must not restrict anyone from making use of the program in a specific field of endeavor. For example, it may not restrict the program from being used in a business or from being used for genetic research. So you couldn't say, we can't use this software in a military context, for example. That would not be an open source license. However, this is where it's interesting with the SSPL. It does not explicitly state that you cannot use the software as a service. It does say that you're going to be affected as a software as a service. But if you can meet the terms of the license, you can still offer software as a service. It's just the license is effectively impossible to meet. Now, the license terms do have a problem, but it's not necessarily the terms that are causing an issue here, it's the intent of the author. So, when they were trying to get this approved by the OSI, they stated this: the circumstances in which the source code sharing provision of SSPL Section 13 is triggered are in fact narrower than those of the AGPL. Applying the SSPL to MongoDB specifically, Section 13 is triggered only in one specific circumstance: when someone offers MongoDB as a service by running and managing MongoDB for third parties. Outside of this, any user of our software, including a licensee who uses MongoDB as the backend database for their own SaaS application, does not have to worry about AGPL's more general trigger for sharing source code. We know from experience that many of our potential users found AGPL's trigger ambiguous, and we have worked hard to make the SSPL trigger both more specific and more understandable. Whilst that may be the case, it could possibly run afoul of point number 6. And due to the conversation around this devolving into absolute noise, before the OSI even came to a full conclusion on what to do about the license, it was actually retracted from the OSI mailing list, probably because they saw the direction it was going and they didn't want to have a clear definition of whether it is or is not open source. And it didn't seem like there was going to be a definition coming anytime soon, as there was a lot of sort of internal struggle within the OSI about whether or not this actually is open source. Again, it doesn't explicitly say that offering cloud services, software as a service, are banned. However, blog posts from Mongo, blog posts from Elastic, and especially blog posts from Redis, who openly talk about how their goal was to get AWS and get Google Cloud to stop using Redis and make their own thing so they can have Redis to themselves. The intention is to discriminate against certain fields of endeavor. Now, how you feel about that very much depends on whether you think the intent of a license is important to what is being done, or the specific phrasing of what is being said instead. I personally don't consider the SSPL to be open source. It is clear to me that the intention of every single party using it is to sort of look open source and have terms that in a magical world could be met, but are not really achievable in a real world context. It provides them the financial benefit of being open source whilst not needing to actually compete in the open source market. I consider this to be a form of open washing. I consider this to be companies who are trying to look open source, but don't really want to act open source. But what do you think? Do you think the SSPL is an open source license and it's just a very, very extreme copyleft license? Or are you on my side and think, yes, that is the case, however, the intention is still very important here? I'd love to know. So if you liked the video, go like the video. If you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, Scribes, Libero Pay link in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and is it? You tell me. What is this?